When he realized that they're going to crucify me, and this is how I will end, he went and he walked outside of the city of Jerusalem. So Jesus left the city, and he went with his disciples, and he stopped somewhere at a garden, and he told them at the gate, watch for what? That means if somebody comes, deal with it. Just watch, because I have some business to handle. Got some business I need to deal with. So Jesus walked down this road, and what did he do? Anyone know? What did he do? Did he go hype himself up to get ready for this crucifixion? He went and he fell on his face and he prayed. Let me tell you something right now. God doesn't pray. God doesn't need to pray. Jesus fell on his face and prayed. And what did he pray? He prayed so fervently, which this, let me tell you right now, this portion of fervently drops of blood, this is not a very authentic, I'm just going to say it because this was in the King James. He fell on his face and prayed so hard that his sweat became as if it were drops of blood. This is a man who needs his prayer answered. I don't know if any of you have ever put your face on the ground and prayed to God so hard that your sweat almost became as if you were bleeding from your pores. If so, you had a serious, serious prayer going on. And what was his prayer? Father, if it be, let this cup pass from me. Father, if it be, let this cup of torture that I'm about to endure pass from me. Meaning, let this thing called crucifixion go away from me. Why? Because he understood, if they crucify me, they'll never believe in me. I've failed my mission. If I go to the cross, the people that I was sent as a Messiah to save will not believe. He said, but nevertheless, whatever is your will, that's what I will do. Submitting to the will of God. Yesterday, we defined submitting to the will of God as what? What is the Arabic word for submitting to the will of God? It's called Islam. Jesus said, I want this cup to pass from me, but nevertheless, whatever is your will, that's what I'll do. And that's where we're going to end it. Because there's a plethora of different theories about what happened after that. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And welcome to all of our guests. I begin by saying Bismillah, in the name of the Creator of all that exists. Alhamdulillah, all praise belongs to that one true Creator. Wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. And may the peace and blessings of the Creator be upon His most noble Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in, and upon his family and his companions, all of them. وَمَنْ تَبِعِهِمْ بِإِحْسَانِ إِلَّا يَوْمِ الدِّينِ, and those who follow them in righteousness until the day of judgment. وَأَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ, and I bear witness that nothing has the right to be worshipped except the one true Creator of all that exists. وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ, who is one alone and he has no partner. He has no one who equals him. وَأَشَدُّ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ, and I bear witness that Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was indeed the slave of Allah, the Creator of all that exists, and his messenger. How is everyone today? So far so good? Alhamdulillah. Let me tell you something, brothers and sisters, for the sake of Allah. If you can't wake up every single day and say that this day is good, it's going to start good and is going to end good, no matter what happens to you throughout that day, then you need to recheck your status as a mu'min. Because a mu'min cannot have a bad day. Our dear Sheikh Saeed Raghi said yesterday that every affair for the believer is good. There's khair in it. No matter whether it's good or bad, intrinsically on its surface, for the believer it's good. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that the affairs of the believers are strange in that it is good in its entirety. We have to remember this, that the affairs of the believers are good is strange because it is good in its entirety. If the believer is given something good, then they are thankful to Allah for it, and that becomes good for them. And if the believer is tested with something from Allah, they are patient with Allah, and that is good for them. And this affair of strangeness for the good and everything they do is only for the believer. We have to remind ourselves of that. This is why the Prophet ﷺ could smile every day of his life, even though he suffered much more than any of us will ever suffer. He smiled every day because he knew that the affairs of the believers are always good. Now, to the topic at hand, Jesus, Isa, Yeshua, peace be upon him, whatever language you want to call him in. Was he a Jew, a Christian, or a Muslim? And I'm sure this is probably going to be one of the most controversial topics of the entire thing. And I got permission from our dear brother Fahad to go all in. So we're going to go all in with this one, inshallah, and explore these three things. Now, in order to do this, I'm going to have to use some historical reference, some deduction, some verses from the Bible, yes, the Bible, and from the Quran. And we're going to have to look at all of these three things separately, in the best of my ability with my 47 minutes left. Number one, was Jesus a Jew? Now, it has to do with, to answer that question properly, I would have to ask the person asking me this question, what do you mean by Jew? Jew by birth? Jew by religion? Jew by heritage? Jesus, peace be upon him, was sent to the children of Israel. As we know in the Quran, Bani Israel. He was sent to the children of Israel as their Messiah. This is something we as Muslims confirm. He was the Messiah to the children of Israel. If you want to call them Jews coming from their forefather Judah, no problem. But they were the children of Israel. And Jesus was sent to them as a prophet, a messenger, and the Messiah. And the Quran refers to it as Al-Masih, meaning the one who is wiped over or anointed, which is what the Christ means, or the Christos in Greek language. This is why Jesus is called Jesus the Christ. The is taken off most of the times. They just say Jesus Christ, but it means Jesus the anointed one. And he was the Messiah to the children of Israel. Now there's something you have to understand about the children of Israel at this point in history and why they were sent their Messiah at this time. The children of Israel at this point had become so detached from the original way of life given to them through the prophets, through Moses, through Abraham, through David, through all of the prophets and what they call the kings of Israel, because the Jews don't really consider the prophets after Moses, they consider them kings, whatever you want to call you. But they had become so detached from religion, so detached from their way of life, that they needed a serious wake-up call. Serious wake-up call. The children of Israel at this time had turned religion, had turned their way of life into empty rituals. Empty rituals that meant nothing. Empty rituals that they just did it because it was what needed to be done. And within the structure of the children of Israel, because at this time they were living in the area we know as Palestine, but they were not free. They were under Roman rule. They were allowed to conduct their own affairs, deal with your business, but when it comes to politics and when it comes to governance and when it comes to taxes, all of that is for Rome and for Caesar. Within this scheme, there was a group of people who had risen to the top. And I wish I could go through this in beautiful detail, but it would take us the whole entire course of days. It would take us all 4 days of me standing here for the entire sessions, morning to night, and I would only scratch the surface. So I'm summarizing. Within this system, there arose two groups of people to the top, and they became kind of the people who ruled over the children of Israel this time. You had the Pharisees and the Sadducees. These people were the people who wrote the Torah with their own hands. They are the scribes for the Torah of Moses and the holders of the law, the people who knew the law, the people who could tell you what the law of Moses says about a certain issue, how to live your life, how to do this, how to cook this, how to make this, how to do this ritual, how to celebrate this festivity, how to do this and that and the other, whatever, how to get married, how to get divorced, all of this. And these two groups, you would figure, would be the most noble amongst them. But they actually became the most corrupt. They were the most evil. Jesus, peace upon him, even referred to them as hypocrites who stand on street corners so that people can watch them pray. He called them a murderous and adulterous nation. They had fallen far away from the true path. And they were using their position to lord over the rest of the children of Israel. That look, you just take care of us. We get rich, you stay poor. We tell you what to do, you just do it. We will deal with God for you. This became a system of hierarchy. Mediators between themselves, between the lower class and God. They held the rites and the rituals and the law and everything. So you treated them differently and they treated themselves differently. And the spirit of the message of God had become lost. It was not there anymore. There was no personal connection with the Creator. It was only empty rituals that were performed with no meaning. Therefore, the spirit of the message of the relationship that the slave of the Creator is supposed to have with its master was gone. Was gone. It wasn't there anymore. So, the Creator of everything that exists, Allah, God Almighty, whatever term you want to use, sent Jesus as a messenger, as a Messiah, to bring them back. To bring them back. And we see this in many, many ways throughout the Bible. So if you want to say that he was a Hebrew from birth, or that he was from the children of Israel, therefore he was a Jew by birth, that's fine. We'll leave that. We can consider that plausible for the moment. We'll leave that one as plausible right now. But in order to go a little bit deeper and further, we have to discuss and find out, what did Jesus say? What did he preach? What did he teach? How did he interact with these children of Israel? How credible is this information? Because I have to use some of it because this is what is believed by the majority of the world. But how credible is the information? And I have to give that disclaimer before we start, the credibility of the information. Number one, everything that we find about Jesus within the Bible, whether in the New Testament, the four canons, which is known as the books of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and also the Acts of the Apostles, which is also used to describe parts of Jesus' life and things that he said and he did. All of these things we find written in a couple of languages. The oldest existing documents we find written in what language? Does anyone know? The older existing documents of the New Testament that talk about Jesus, what language do we find them in? Find them in the Koine Greek. Find them in the Koine Greek. And then some of them were translated over to Latin and put in the Latin Vulgate and things of that nature. Now the interesting fact about this, and I just have to tell you this before I start telling you all of these things. Did Jesus speak either one of these languages as his daily language? Anybody know? What language did Jesus speak as everyday language? Anybody know? Aramaic. In his daily conversation, he would have used the language of Aramaic because the place where he's from in Galilee, this is the language that was known, Aramaic. Doesn't mean that he didn't understand Hebrew and things of that nature, but this was his normal language. Was Aramaic. So, and the Aramaic language is a very difficult language. It's only really spoken in one place in the world now, in Syria, in a mountain village called, I think, Maulala is the name of it. It's a very hard language to find. But we find no documents about what Jesus said or teached or preached in his mother tongue. The ones that we do have are translations of what somebody heard, may have heard him say, or wrote down what he said later into another language, and then it was translated over into another language, Latin Vulgate, which is now translated over, the English Bible was translated over from that Latin Vulgate. And there are some scholars that went back and tried to translate from the Koine Greek, but it's difficult because those documents are fragmented. Can't go too deep or I'm going to confuse everyone, including myself. But we have to understand where this stuff comes from before I start giving it to you. You got to have the trace of it. Now, all of these documents that make up what Jesus said and did from the canon and the Acts of the Apostles, all of these are in fragmented variations. The number is about 7,000 different documents that now make up what we know as the Bible. 7,000 different documents that were found from all over and pieces all over the world. And some of them agree with each other and some of them disagree with each other. But one thing that is very unique about these documents is that there is no history of their origin. We know where the certain document may have been found, and some of it we can deduce who may have written it, like the Acts, or I mean like the letters of Paul and some of the things of this nature. But when it comes to the canon and Jesus, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, we don't know their author. We deduce the author, and biblical scholars deduce the author, but the author is not verified because nobody signed any of these documents. Now, there is no chain of information on how these documents got where they were today. These documents that are in Germany, we have no chain. There is no one telling on this document that I heard this from so-and-so, who heard this from so-and-so, who heard it from so-and-so, and all these people are trustworthy, therefore I'm relating to this information on trustworthy basis. Even Luke himself said, I am writing things which are seem too good to me. I'm writing the things about Jesus which seem good. And we do know from the church fathers that all of the four canon gospels are somewhat copyrighted from something else. We know that there was a document that existed before any four, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, known as the Q document, according to the church fathers, Josephus and Irenaeus and others like that nature. That there was a Q document, and then Mark, the oldest gospel, copied some of his information from this Q document, and then Luke copied from him in Matthew, and then John is the synoptic gospel to which we don't know the trace very clearly. So that being said, I can now give you the information. So you're not sitting here thinking that I'm holding on to all this information like it is rock solid. We're going to discuss a few things today to find out Jesus, Jew, Christian, or Muslim. Now, the word Christian, is a later term coined for some of the adherents of Jesus' teachings. Does anyone know what the word Christian means? What does it mean? Can anybody tell me what the word Christian means? Any hand? We have a hand? Nope. Let me tell you then. It means to be Christ-like. In the image of Christ. The likeness of Christ. Meaning someone who is like Jesus. So that one we can toss out right away. Because how could Jesus be himself be like himself? This one we can just toss out and leave that for a moment. So what was Jesus? What did he preach? What did he teach? What did he follow, if he followed any code of conduct himself? And finally, was he crucified for the sins of humanity? We have to discuss this. This is a big axis upon which there is a difference of opinion between major religions. Number one, and of course I'm going to quote from the Bible, and I said the Quran. And I'm not going to be able to quote you every verse and the verse that's before it and the verse that's after it in the context and the sentence, which I know is what's going to be said, that look, you pulled things out of context. If anyone thinks I did, you can ask me in the Q&A session or you can come and see me afterwards. No problem. This has been my life ever since I've known it, is about this individual. Now, there are some statements about Jesus we have to understand something really quickly. Number one, Jesus spoke in one of two ways throughout the canon. Spoke in one of two ways. And by the way, one of my fields of study beyond psychology was biblical textual criticism. So this is something that I can speak to with a little bit of authority. Just a little bit, not much. Jesus spoke in one of two ways most of the time throughout the canon. He spoke implicitly and explicitly. These are principles you have to understand, or none of the things that I say will make sense. He spoke implicitly and explicitly. Can anyone tell me what an implicit statement is? An implicit statement. If I make an implicit statement, what does that statement mean? Anybody know? Implicit statement means an implied statement that can be interpreted in many ways. Everyone understand that now? An implicit statement is an implied statement that can be translated in many different ways. For instance, if I say that this podium is dark colored, that's an implicit statement, correct? Because if you didn't see this for yourself, you could say maybe he meant it was black, maybe he meant it was dark gray, it was dark brown, it was dark blue, whatever it was dark. But you could debate about what I said, correct? Now, the difference with an implicit statement and an explicit statement is what? What's an explicit statement? What does the word explicit mean? Direct, clear, clear cut. No difference of opinion about this statement. For instance, if I say this podium is black, there's no one that can come after and said, no, he said it was blue, or he said it was green. No, he was very clear about what this podium was. It was black. So that's the difference between implicit and explicit. Explicit statements, clear cut. Implicit statements can be interpreted on the light of whoever wants to interpret them. Now let me ask all of you a question. Which do you think is a more weighty statement? An explicit statement or an implicit statement? Which one holds more weight? How many of you agree, or excuse me, how many of you would say an implicit statement, meaning one that is implied that can be translated by anybody, is the more weighty statement? Raise your hand. Didn't think so. Any who say it's explicit statement is a more weighty, raise your hand. We have an ijma, mashallah. We're getting somewhere now. Now, in a court of law, can an explicit statement be interpreted in the light of an implicit one? I'm trying to go slow so you understand. Can an explicit statement, meaning this table is black, be interpreted in the light of an implicit statement? Meaning, can you say that when I said the table was black, what I meant that it was dark colored, so it might be dark brown? Would that make any sense to anyone? No, people would look at you like you're a fool. An explicit statement will always hold the greater weight. And an implicit statement made by the same individual must be interpreted in the light of their explicit statements. Like if I said today this was black, and tomorrow I said it was dark colored, then how would you interpret my statement, it's dark colored? You would interpret it by yesterday me saying it was black, correct? So now you know what I meant by dark colored. Very clear, very clear. Is everybody with me so far? Kinda, somewhat. Hopefully you'll go back and watch the recording and slow it down and maybe get everything. Now Jesus spoke in these two ways, implicit and explicit. Which is going to be more weighty? The explicit statements, correct? And those is statements which are implicit must be interpreted in the light of the explicit ones. Yes or no? Can we agree upon this? This is simple. This is the human mind and logic at work. MashaAllah. If we used our logic like this most of the time, we would be good to go. Now, a couple of things Jesus said explicitly. And I wish I could give you all his explicit statements. It's actually something I'm working on authoring. Not just the four canon, but also the lost gospels and the lost statements of Jesus that are scattered as well, that have been tossed out of the canon due to political reasons which we can't go down, that happened in 310, 315, and 318 with the councils of Nicaea. But I will give you a few things that Jesus said, and I will let you make your own deductions. I'm not going to sit here and answer this question for you today, because I could answer it in one sentence and walked off the stage. I'm going to leave it for yourself. One thing that all of my quotes are going to come from the King James Version Bible. There's a number of versions, but I just grew up with the King James Version, so I'm just going to use the King James Version. Not the most authoritative translation, but it is what it is. In John 13, and I like to use John because it's the synoptic gospel. In John 13 and 16, Jesus said, and this is about what Jesus preached through the canon. Verily I say unto you, the servant is not greater than the master. Truly I tell you, that the servant is not greater than the master, meaning the master is greater than the servant, nor is the one who is sent greater than the one who sent him. Nor is the one that is sent greater than the one who sent him. So what Jesus just said was, the master is greater than the servant, and the one who sent him is greater than the one who was sent. Meaning God that sent him, and you can deduce that however you want, I'm going to leave it as implicit. You can think that Jesus was talking about himself or somebody else, who knows. But he said that the person who was sent by God was not greater than the one who sent him, meaning God is greater. Also, John 14, Jesus said, what is reported in the canon, you have heard how I say to you, I must go. I have to go. I got to leave. I got to be out of here. You know how we say that? I got to be out. Jesus said, look, you've heard me tell you I got to be out. If you loved me, you would rejoice. For I say, I go into the Father. And you have to understand the word Father was a word that is still used among Jews today to refer to God. They won't refer to God by name. They will refer to him as Lord, as Father, as things of his nature. He said, I go into the Father. Why? Because the Father is greater than I. He said, I have to go and you should be happy because I'm going into the Father. And the Father is greater than I. Meaning that he was somewhere and the Father was somewhere else. The creator of all that exists was somewhere else and he was here. And he said, I have to go. I have to travel unto the Father because he's greater than I. Also, a man came to Jesus. And I wish I could go through all of the reasons why they wanted to crucify him and everything, but we don't have time, unfortunately. Because there was a reason why the Jews wanted him crucified. There was a specific reason, and it was going all the way back to a verse in Deuteronomy, part of the law, where he would be cursed by being hanging on a tree. We'll see if I can get to it, but I really seriously doubt it. Now, a man came to Jesus, one of these holders of the law, one of these scholars of the law came to Jesus. And he wanted to ask Jesus a trick question. There are many trick questions that was asked to him throughout the canon because they wanted him to be disgraced. They wanted to trick him. Why? Because they didn't like him. Why didn't they like Jesus? Jesus came blazing with miracles. He made dead people come out of the ground. He made people who had never seen in their life see. People who were sick, he healed them. Lepers, he healed them. So many blazing miracles he was showing them right in front of their face. Do you want to see it? I will show you. So why didn't they like him? Why would someone, this holder of the law, who knows that they're waiting for the Messiah to come, and here's a man standing in front of them saying, I am your Messiah. Why did they hate him so much? You have to understand the psychology going on, because if you don't understand the psychology of what is happening, then you will never understand why. And that's one of the problems we've had in dealing with this issue between Islam and Christianity is the psychology is gone. We don't understand the thinking process. The children of Israel at first could have very well looked at Jesus as a savior. That this is it. This is our Messiah. He was at the age of 6 in the synagogues just baffling the Pharisees and Sadducees. Just utterly confounding them. But you see, when Jesus began his mission, he spoke of the kingdom of God, which is what the children of Israel were waiting for. They were waiting for their Messiah to come and bring the kingdom of God. But they thought that that kingdom would be here in this world. They thought that their Messiah would come and sit on the throne of David and rule over the world with the law of Moses. And that they would be kings on earth again. This is what they thought their Messiah was going to do. Why? Because the children of Israel had become so attached to this world that they couldn't see any good if it didn't happen here. If they weren't given good here, they couldn't see any good. And this is very clearly in the Quran, where Allah says, if you were to give one of them the life of 1,000 years, it wouldn't be enough. It wouldn't be enough. They cling to the earth. They grip this earth. And as I was talking about with Sheikh Haytham last night, he said he knows a brother who's seen a lot of these children of Israel die, and the way they'll grip this dunya, the way they'll hold on to things of this world just proves that they only can see good here. It's unfortunate, but it's the reality. And Jesus is standing here telling them, hold on a second. The kingdom of God is not in this world. The kingdom of God is in the next life. The reality is in the next life. And they're looking at him like, you must be out of your mind. If there is no kingdom here, we don't want it. We don't need it. And on top of that, Jesus was sitting here blatantly challenging these Pharisees and Sadducees to knock them off of their pedestal by calling them hypocrites who stand on the street corners to pray, by calling them a murderous and adulterous nation, by entering into Jerusalem. And I don't know whether it was the first thing he did or one of the last things after entering, because it's different in two of the canons. But when he entered into Jerusalem, he went into the temple, or the place where Allah, God Almighty, and the word Jesus used for God was Allah, it's the Aramaic word for the Creator. He went into the synagogue and flipped a table where people were changing money and threw them out and said, this is not the place for this. So Jesus was doing something that will get you wrangled and murdered and put in prison every single time. You know what he did? You know what his greatest crime was? Anybody know? His greatest crime was to challenge the status quo and go directly at the heads of evil. I don't care who you are, where you come from, what your message is, but the moment you challenge things the way they are, especially when the way they are people who are at a higher echelon, a small section of society, lording themselves over everyone else, using their power and their wealth to lord over and tyrannize people. If you come to challenge that system and you come directly to challenge the heads of that evil authority, you will become public enemy number one. It's just gonna happen. I don't care who you are, you will be public enemy number one. And so Jesus had to be dealt with. And one of the first ways they tried to deal with him was to get him to say things that they could use against him. Get him to say things they could use against him. Because could they have just killed him? Sure, why not? They had killed many other prophets and messengers that came to them from before. They could have killed him and threw him in a ditch. But guess what happens to someone like Jesus who comes with blazing miracles, who people have seen, and you just kill him off? You might kill the man, but you don't kill the message. You might kill the man, but you can't get rid of the message. So what do they need to do? They need to attack the messenger. You have to attack the messenger so the message will go down with him. So this holder of the law came to Jesus and said, good master, we hear that you're a good teacher. We've been told that you're a good teacher. Teach me, what is the greatest commandment? He asked the man, what is the greatest commandment that God has given us? This was a trick question. There's almost no real right answer because they're all considered equal. Jesus said, hold on a second. Let me tell you something. I cannot tell you what is the greatest commandment before I tell you what is the first commandment. And what was the first commandment? Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one. And you should love that Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your strength. And then you should love your neighbor like you love yourself. He said all of the law, all of the prophets hang upon these two principles. Man, that's some deep stuff right there, let me tell you. It's very deep. It's one of the most beautiful statements I found in the canon, believe it or not. Now let me ask every Muslim here in the room. If I told you that Islam was about this, Islam is about there is one God who is worthy of all of your worship, who is worthy of everything, and you're supposed to love him with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your strength, and then you're supposed to love your neighbor like you love yourself, and Islam is based upon these principles, would I be right or wrong? Would I be correct or incorrect? How many of you think I would be correct if I said that? That what Jesus just taught us is Islam, our religion that we practice right now. Absolutely. Everything in Islam can be put into two categories if you wanted to. You can put one of it in a category that the rights that belong to your creator. The rights that you as an individual have to give to the creator of all that exists. Correct? Like salah and zakah and all these other things. And then on the other side, I could put rights that belong to the creation. Meaning how you deal with individuals, your social interacting. And I could say that every law in Islam will fit into one of these two sides if you wanted to give them two categories. Would I be correct or incorrect? Would be correct. This is Islam. Now, I want to give you something small as well. When Jesus spoke, he was quoting from the law of Moses given to the children of Israel. When he said, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one." Now, the interesting word, and I'm not going to give it to you because I want you to do some homework. If I just hand feed you everything, it's kind of like teaching the man to fish. I can give you a fish sandwich today and you're going to be eating for right now. But if I teach you to fish, then I won't have to feed you again. When Jesus quoted from that verse, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one," that word "one" that is used in the Torah, in the Old Testament, the Pentateuch, whatever you want to call it, that word "one" is not the Hebrew number one, like one. There's one me standing up here. That's not the word that's used. It's not the word that's used. The word that's used is a word that means a unified one, meaning a one that is alone by itself. And for all of our, and I want you to go research it. Go find that verse, go look it up, go do some Hebrew, go do a little homework. Why not? Find it out for yourself. If I'm wrong, everybody in here knows you can get in touch with me very easily. My name is my website. Tell me I'm wrong. For our brothers and sisters to understand, there Allah speaks very similar in the Quran. Almost the exact same statement. "Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one." Exact same statement we find in Surah Ikhlas. Chapter 112 of the Quran has the same phrase, almost in the exact same syntax, because Hebrew and Arabic have a very similar grammatical syntax structure. What does verse 1 of chapter 112 of the Quran say? Somebody tell me. If you can't tell me, I'm coming off the stage. I'm going back to the hotel. What does Surah Ikhlas, chapter 112, say in this first verse? قُلْ, say, هُوَ اللَّهُ, he is Allah, what? أَحَد, one. Wait a minute, hold on a second. Is أَحَد the Arabic number for one? What is the Arabic word for the number one? وَاحِد, similar root, but وَاحِد means one, right? I have وَاحِد, cup of water in my hand. Now, if I add this other cup, now how many cups of water do I have? One plus one is two, ithnain. I can add, I can subtract, I can multiply, I can divide that number wahid. But now Allah doesn't say he is wahid in this verse. It is one of the names of Allah, leave it alone. But in this verse, Allah is very clear in his construct. He says, "Qul huwa Allahu ahad." Now the word ahad means what? It also means one, right? But it's a different type of one. The word ahad, if I take it and I say, okay, I'm going to add this ahad to another ahad. These two ones, I'm going to add them together. What do I get? What do you get if you add ahad to ahad? You can't. The very word ahad itself describes a oneness that cannot be added to. A oneness that cannot be subtracted from. A oneness that is unique and on its own. And Allah is the only thing that is ahad. Alone by himself, no partner, no equal, nothing. He is ahad. Yes or no? This is what Jesus said. "Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one." Go do the research yourself. Find the Hebrew number for one in ancient Hebrew and look at the word, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one." And come and tell me if it's the same word. It's not. And this was Jesus' message to this holder of the law. That the greatest law is the first law. "Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one." Love that God with everything you have. Love your neighbor like you love yourself. You're fine. All the law and the prophets hang on these two principles. You see what Jesus was teaching? He was teaching the spirit of the law. He was trying to put the spirit back into God's teachings. that they had stripped away. He was trying to show people that connection that you're supposed to have with God. You love Him with all your heart, with all your might, with all your strength. Beautiful message. Now, by the way, that's in Mark 12, 19 through 21. Mark 12, if you're taking notes. Now, there was another man in Matthew who came to Jesus and said to Him, "Oh, good master, teach me something. Good master, teach me something." Jesus responded by teaching him a lesson. He said, "I'm going to teach you this." He said, "Why are you calling me good? Why are you calling me good? For there is only one source of good." And I'm not going to quote it the King James because it's not translated properly from the Koine Greek nor the Latin. He said, "Why do you call me good? For there is only one that is the source of good, and that is God." He said, "Why are you calling me good? Because I'm not good. The only source of good in this life is from God. So if you want to call anyone good, call the Father, your Creator, good." This is a man who clearly is distinguishing himself from that which he worships. From the God that created everything, Jesus is clearly making a distinction. You don't call me good, for the God that is good, the only good is God. The Master's not greater than the Father. I have to go to the Father. The Father is greater than I. Distinctions clearly, explicit distinction that me and God are not the same. We're not alike. I am the one He sent to you. That's it. Also, in John chapter 20, and this is purportedly later on when Mary Magdalene sees Him on the road, He says unto her, "I ascend unto my Father." I gotta go. I'm out. Basically, this is the last person who's gonna see me. I'm out. I gotta go. "I ascend unto my Father and your Father." He equated God with her. That my Father, your Father. Then He said, "My God and your God." He said, "I'm going unto the Father. My Father, your Father, my God, your God." Meaning that the God that I worship is the same as your God. We are on equal footing in front of Him. Me and you. A woman. And if you want to know who Mary Magdalene is, go do some research about her. He equated His God with her. That my God and your God. You'll find this in John 20, 17. So what did Jesus teach? He taught that God was the greatest thing. That God was greater than everything else. The Master is greater than His servants. Meaning that God is greater than everything which He has created. And that's my interpretation. I'm leaving it as it is. You can interpret how you want to interpret. It was pretty explicit statements to me. He also said that my God, your God, my Father, your Father, the Father is greater than I. There is no good in me except the Father who has sent me is good. All good comes from God. This is what Jesus taught to people. To love God with all your heart, with all your might, with all your strength. Love your neighbor like you love yourself. This is it. This is the key to life. Also, when Jesus taught His disciples how to pray, and you'll find this in Matthew 6 and 9 and in a couple other places, but I'm just choosing one. He taught the disciples how to pray. How did He teach them how to pray? Anybody in here know the Lord's Prayer? Anybody in the room know the Lord's Prayer that is taught in the Bible? All right. Jesus taught His disciples to pray like this. He said, "Pray and say, Our Father." Who is where? Anybody know? Our Father who art in heaven. Our Father who art in heaven. He taught God is in heaven. Our Father who art in heaven. Hallowed be your name. Mean praise be your name. Sanctified be your name. Does this sound familiar to anybody so far? How could I translate this statement in the Arabic language? Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. All praise, glorification belongs to the Creator who is the Lord over all the worlds. He said, "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." Meaning that God's will should be done here on earth as it is in heaven. "Give us this day our daily bread." Mean give us something. Give us our daily bread, whether it be the bread of sustaining my physical life or the bread that sustains my spiritual life. Give me that guidance. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against. I'll probably mix up a couple along the end. It's been a long time. Forgive us our trespasses. Mean forgive us our sins as we forgive those who have sinned against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Lead us not into temptation. And he's using us the whole time. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Did I at just now say anything that a Muslim is not allowed to say? For me, when I read Surah Al-Fatiha, at first I thought it was copied from the Lord's Prayer. Until I learned much later that it's from the same source. Because the Fatiha begins as what? All praise belongs to the Creator, Allah, the Lord of all that exists. We praise Him and Him alone. We seek His assistance, meaning spiritually and physically, and His assistance alone. What's the next verse? Oh my goodness, seriously. What's the next verse of the Fatiha? Guide us to the straight path. Guide us to the straight path. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Lead us to the straight path, not the path of those who have earned your anger, nor of those who have gone astray. The Lord's Prayer is divided into two halves. The first half praises God. The second half asks for deliverance. The Fatiha is in two portions. The first half is praising God. The second half is asking for deliverance. Yes or no? Just a side note. And I'll give you one really quick side note. Never mind, we'll leave that. We've got 7 minutes. Maybe if we Q&A sessions, I'll get to it. Now, also in Matthew, with the gospel according to whoever Matthew was, because it wasn't Matthew the disciple, because he refers to himself in the third person too many times, and this was not the style of writing. You didn't write in third person. You didn't write an eyewitness narrative in the third person. This doesn't work like that. Now, in Matthew 5 and 16, Jesus tells his disciples, "Let your light shine before men that they may see your good works. Let your light shine before men so that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven." So Jesus clearly taught that God was in heaven. God was not here on this earth. God was in heaven. You praise the God who is in heaven. Now, since I'm running out of time, we got to speed along. Did Jesus follow a code of conduct? Meaning, did he live by a law himself? Or did he make it up as he went along? Or did he change the law? What happened? Now, the Pharisees and the Sadducees accused Jesus of breaking the law one day because he was walking through the cornfields on a Sabbath day. According to them, he was breaking the law. This was not to be done on the Sabbath. And Jesus said something to them very beautifully. He said a couple of things, but this one was very beautiful. He said, "Don't think that I have come to destroy the law or the prophets. I have not come but to fulfill them." He said, "I am not here to destroy the law. I am here to fulfill the law. The law that was given to you through Moses, I am its fulfillment." He said, "And not one single thing, not a period nor a comma, shall go away from the law until it is all fulfilled by me." So Jesus was clearly telling them that, look, I'm not here to do away with the law. I'm here to fulfill it. I am here to perfect the law. It's a better translation for the Greek word that is used. Whether or not that's the proper word Jesus said, I don't know, because like I said, it didn't speak Koine Greek. But Jesus said, "I am here to fulfill and perfect the law for you." And he also taught them that the law was given from God for man, not the other way around. It's not you who dictates the law. It is the God that is in heaven that dictates the law to you. You just follow it. Now, this law thing that Jesus is speaking about was the law that was given through who? Through whom? Through Moses, through Musa, the Torah, the law that was given to them. Jesus saying that I am here to fulfill that law. And then he said, whoever breaks the least of these commandments, meaning the law, whoever breaks the least of these commandments, and he teaches other people to break the commandments. Meaning if there's someone who comes along that breaks the commandments and the laws of God and then tells you to break the commandments and the law of God, he is the least person in the kingdom of heaven. I mean, this person is not good. This is the least person in God's kingdom. The worst person that exists is someone who breaks the law and then he goes around teaching other people to break the law. He said, but someone who obeys the law and fulfills the law and teaches other people to fulfill that law, this person will be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. So this law thing that Jesus was talking about, he considered it very serious. He considered following God's law very serious. So serious that a man came to him, and his name was Lazarus, was a rich man, came to him and said, good master, tell me, how do I inherit eternal life? How do I inherit eternal life? Meaning, how do I go to heaven? He's asking Jesus, how do I go to heaven? Jesus responded by saying, obey the commandments. Jesus told the man, obey God. Obey God. That's what God wants from you. He wants your worship and your obedience. This is the God of the Old Testament. The God of the Pentateuch, the Torah, was a God who wanted to be worshipped and obeyed. That's it. You obey him and you worship him and you will be just fine. And this is what Jesus told the man. Obey the commandments. The man said, I've done that. I'm good with that. The commandments between me and God, knock those out already. Jesus said, well, if you are perfect in front of the law, which is an impossibility. We know that as Muslims. Any of you in here perfect in front of the law of God? Can't do it. We're not perfect. He said, if you're that perfect, then go sell everything you have. Pick up your burden, meaning improperly translated cross. The word cross does not exist in the Latin Vulgate nor the Koine Greek. He said, pick up your burden and come follow me. Meaning what? Go sell everything. Get that money. We gotta have that money. The da'wah would take some money, which we'll talk about tomorrow. Go sell everything you have. Pick up your burden. Come follow me. Mean work for me. Do what I'm doing. Help me out. I got 12 disciples. I could use one more. Why not? Baker's dozen. Go sell everything and come help me. The man walked away crying. Why? Because he knew he wasn't perfect in front of the law. He knew what he was talking was nothing. So he left crying. And Jesus did not stop him and say, wait a minute, come back. This whole law thing, I'm going to take care of it when I sacrifice myself on the cross. You're not going to have to worry about that law. Just believe in me and that's it. You can say that Jesus said, those who believe in me shall not perish but have everlasting life. And I agree with that. The children of Israel who believed in Jesus Christ as their Messiah would have not perished but had everlasting life. I agree with that. No problem. It's in a congruency with all the other explicit statements. And it's not implied. So Jesus told the man about the law. Now, lastly, because we're running out of time, and unfortunately I'm not going to be able to cover everything I wanted to cover. I knew it would in 47 minutes. When Jesus was brought up on charges for crucifixion, there was a reason they wanted to crucify him. They had to get rid of the message and the messenger. They had to destroy everything. They had to discredit Jesus. Can't just kill him, can't lock him up, we got to discredit him. And the way we can discredit him is we can have him crucified. Because according to the law of Moses in Deuteronomy, anything that hangs on a tree, meaning if you crucify a criminal, is accursed of God. Meaning there is no good for them in this life or the next. This person has a curse on them for eternity. They're done. If you crucify someone, they're done. It's over. This is the law. And Jesus is saying that he's here to perfect the law. So do you know how foolish it would have looked to the children of Israel that their Messiah, the person who's telling them that he's their Messiah, who's fulfilling the law, is accursed as a criminal under that same law? This is why the Jews laugh at a crucified Messiah. It's an oxymoron. It is an oxymoron. You can't have a Messiah that is accursed. So what did they do? They said, we have to get him crucified. And when they brought him up on charges, and I'm going to go a couple of minutes over, it's okay, I'll cut down from the Q&A session because this has to be finished. When he was brought up in front of Pontius Pilate, who was the governor of Palestine at the time, he was not brought up on charges of calling himself God. Was he? Why would the Romans care about a man calling himself God? You tell me, how many gods did the Romans have? How many? A plethora of gods who warred and did battle and fought and killed each other and slept with each other's sisters and all kinds of craziness. It was a soap opera of gods. So one other man who says he's God and he's healing people and he's bringing dead back to life, they might have just said, you know what, let's just add him on in. Why not? If he's a god, then let's see it. He wasn't brought up for that because Pontius Pilate nor Caesar would have cared about that. What he was brought up on charges of was calling himself the King of the Jews. He was saying, I am the King of the Jews. And the Jews were telling Pontius, this is a challenge to the throne of Rome. Our Messiah, if he's our Messiah, he's going to run all of you out of here. He's going to take this, you know what, over, and we're going to run this. So what you going to do about it? Is there anything different than what happens today? Snitches selling you out. The people who you thought you were down with, throwing you right up under the bus. Nothing new. And let me tell you something about Caesar. Caesar did not tolerate anyone challenging his authority. It was a penalty of death right away. But when Pontius interviewed Jesus, he said, I don't find any fault in this man. What do you want? There's nothing wrong with this man, because they said, do you know what they say of you? They are saying that you're calling yourself this and that and the third. He said, that's what you say. He didn't agree. I don't know what world you live in when you tell someone, hey man, you're a fool. Well, that's what you say. Well, I agreed to that. I don't know what language that is that I agreed to that statement. I just didn't have time to deal with it. That's what you say, man. I have no time for this. That's what Jesus said. I have no time for this. So Pontius actually tried to give him back. Said, man, take this man back. Do with him as you wish. They said, no, you must crucify him. And Pontius realizes he's about to have a riot in the streets of Jerusalem. They're about to tear this mother down. I got to figure out what to do with Jesus. It's going to go crazy. Caesar's going to come here and take away my authority because I can't keep control of the people under me. So Pontius tried to give them a choice. There was a man named Barabbas. Does anyone know what the word Barabbas means? Barabbas. Anybody know? Barabbas means son of the father. Son of the father is what Barabbas means. So Pontius asked the Jews, because it was the time of year they would let go of one criminal, and Barabbas was the worst of them. That's why he brought him up, because he's figuring there's no way in their bloody crazy minds they're going to take this guy back. This guy, they don't want him. So they said, look, well, I'll give you Jesus of Nazareth, or I'll give you Barabbas, son of the father. Do you know who they chose? They said, give us Barabbas and do away with Jesus. Now, when Jesus realized, because as this was going on, he was on some sort of bail, meaning he wasn't locked up and shackled, he was just being questioned every day. When he realized that they're going to crucify me, and this is how I will end, promise, 2 minutes, he went and he walked outside of the city of Jerusalem. We have anybody here that's ever been to Al-Quds? Raise your hand. Anybody ever been to Jerusalem? Raise your hand. Or you're from Jerusalem? No? We got to get us a trip from Norway to Quds one day, inshallah. In Jerusalem, there's a garden called the Garden of, anybody know? Gethsemane, where Jesus went. And this garden is outside the city. It's not inside of the ancient Al-Quds, it's outside. So Jesus left the city. And he went with his disciples and he stopped somewhere at a garden and he told them at the gate, watch, watch. Watch for what? That means if somebody comes, deal with it. Just watch, because I have some business to handle. Got some business I need to deal with. So Jesus walked down this road, and what did he do? Anyone know? What did he do? Did he go hype himself up to get ready for this crucifixion? He went and he fell on his face and he prayed. Let me tell you something right now. God doesn't pray. God doesn't need to pray. Jesus fell on his face and prayed. And what did he pray? He prayed so fervently, which this, let me tell you right now, this portion of fervently, drops of blood, this is not a very authentic, this is just, I'm just going to say it because this is what's in the King James. He fell on his face and prayed so hard that his sweat became as if it were drops of blood. This is a man who needs his prayer answered. I don't know if any of you have ever put your face on the ground and prayed to God so hard that your sweat almost became as if you were bleeding from your pores. If so, you had a serious, serious prayer going on. And what was his prayer? Father, if it be, let this cup pass from me. Father, if it be, let this cup of torture that I'm about to endure pass from me. Meaning, let this thing called crucifixion go away from me. Why? Because he understood, if they crucify me, they'll never believe in me. I've failed my mission. If I go to the cross, the people that I was sent as a Messiah to save will not believe. He said, but nevertheless, whatever is your will, that's what I will do. Submitting to the will of God. Yesterday, we defined submitting to the will of God as what? What is the Arabic word for submitting to the will of God? It's called Islam. Jesus said, I want this cup to pass from me, but nevertheless, whatever is your will, that's what I'll do. And that's where we're going to end it. Because there's a plethora of different theories about what happened after that. And we don't know. But one thing I do know for sure is that Jesus came to save the children of Israel from the detriment that they had placed themselves in. And he did so by trying to bring them back not only to the law of God, but to a personal spiritual relationship with their Creator. He tried to remove this hierarchy where there were people who were higher in God just because of a title that they possessed. He tried to teach people that the only greatness in front of God is your piety, is your righteousness, is your works, is what you do, not who you are and what hat you wear. And Jesus really was concerned about the souls of humanity. He was here to save their souls. He was so sincere that he even said, Father, just like they're in my hand, they're in your hands. They're in your hands now. I gotta go. They're up to you now. And he left. And he left. However you say he left, he left. But for sure, we can say one thing about Jesus. He's coming back. Christians believe that. Muslims believe that as part of our aqidah. Jesus will return and set the record straight. And we will argue about it day in, day out, night in, night out, weekend, month, year, until that happens. And when he comes, he will set the record straight. But one thing I want to finish with is a verse from the Quran that speaks about Jesus and his birth and his first miracle. It was not turning water into wine. His first miracle recorded in the Quran, which is a book that is purely from God, unchallenged for 1400 plus years. This verse says that when Jesus was born, Mary, the best woman, one of the best women to ever walk the face of this globe, she brought this baby in front of her family and they said, what kind of wickedness, what kind of craziness have you brought before us? You've never been married before and you have a baby. Mary didn't even need to defend herself. This is what I found beautiful about the story of Jesus' birth in the Quran. In the Bible, there is no clarification on how Mary defended the accusations of adultery. But she pointed at the baby and said, ask him. Let him speak for himself. He was an infant. And Jesus said, very beautifully, that I, Jesus, was sent as a prophet and a messenger. I'm just summarizing it for you because then we're ending. And my mother is of purity and chastity. And I have been made to be forbearing to her all the days of my life. And peace is on me. The day that I was born, the day that I will die, and the day that I will be resurrected unto life. And then God says in the Quran, this is a statement of truth about Jesus, the son of Mary, of which they vainly dispute about. And he said, the God, creator of all mankind, that Jesus to me is like Adam. I created him from dust and I said to him, be, and he was. So this is Jesus. and did the best of my capacity that I could do in running over time. Any questions that you have, come out, but make your own decision. Jew, Christian, or someone who submitted to the will of God. Thank you very much for your time and patience, and I look forward to you afterwards. Now, as I said yesterday, and I need to clarify for all of you that da'wah means inviting people to accept tawheed. If you don't invite anyone to accept Islam, you have not done any da'wah. You've shared information, you've given a risala, a message. Da'wah is an invitation. So as I said yesterday, if there is anyone in this room that has come to this place, not yet a Muslim, and after hearing everything they've heard throughout the past couple of days or however long you've been here, and you have decided that this is a way of life that I want to enter, submitting myself to my God, my Creator, living His life, living my life the way He wants me to live it, you can raise your hand right now. Is there anyone in the room? Is there anyone in the room? I heard we had two shahadas this morning, yeah? Or three?
Two.
Two sisters, right? That's just the way it always works, the sisters. Sisters are gonna outnumber us like madness. Mm-hmm. Is there anyone in this room? Again, not disappointed, because God is the only one who guides. It's not in my hands or in anyone else's hands in this room. It's a personal thing between you and your Creator. If any time you decide that you want to enter into this beautiful way of life called Islam and you want to start living your life the way God wants you to live it, find any one of these Muslims that are here and tell them that's what you want to do, and they'll know exactly where to direct you. So now we will start the Q&A session. We have 21 minutes, so we will begin so we can get as much done as possible. Please, I ask one request.
You can't find yourself.
And this is the only time I'm gonna be nice about it. If you want to ask a question based upon the topic. If you want to make a statement to me, I will be here for the next few hours, you can do that. But if you start to make a statement and you want to just challenge me, this is not the platform to do it. We can do it outside. I will stop you immediately and you'll be escorted out of the room. It's very simple. I didn't disrespect anyone and I will not tolerate disrespect. Questions?
Do we have any sisters who have any questions? If you have any questions, you can also send SMS to the numbers you see on the posters.
Any questions from the sisters?
Any brothers who have any questions?
And again, if you want me to clarify something, no problem.
We have a question.
I just didn't have the time to go as deep as I wanted to.
What will happen when Jesus will return? It's a question by SMS.
What will happen when Jesus will return? According to the statements of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, authentic statements, meaning these statements have been verified, we know who said it and who he told it to, and we know who that person, and that person is truthfully known, and we know who said it, who heard it, and who heard it from the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, all the way down. Meaning that we know he said this statement. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said when Jesus returns, his first order of business will be what? Anybody know? Come on. Hello? I told you I like to question. What will he do first? I'll give you a hint. He'll break the cross. Break the cross, meaning what? I wasn't crucified. Look at me. I'm here. Breaks the cross. Because we believe that Jesus was taken up into heaven without death. That he has not yet suffered death. But he will. He'll break the cross and then he'll kill the swine. Why does he kill a pig? Why? What is the symbolism behind killing the pig? Pig is filthy. Yes, but it has a symbol behind it. What was the symbol? I never told you to break the law. I never gave you the right to break the law of God. Meaning you're never supposed to eat this. This is filthy animal that God told you to stay away from. You're supposed to obey the law. And then after that, he will do war with the Antichrist. He will head towards Israel, what is known as Babul Lud, which is where Tel Aviv airport is right about now. He will head there and do war with the Dajjal, but the Dajjal won't even be able to take the side of him. All Jesus will do is look at the Dajjal and he'll melt like salt. And then he will live a normal life, will have a normal family, he'll die, and he'll be buried where? Anybody know where he'll be buried? Authentically? He'll be buried next to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, Abu Bakr and Umar. Any of you been to Medina and walked by the Prophet's grave? There's an empty spot, is there not? There's an empty spot there that the Prophet, peace be upon him, specifically told them, leave this for Jesus. Still there to this day. You can't see it from the outside, But if you get close enough to the gate and the sheikhs don't slap you, then you might actually see that empty spot in the back right. Any other questions? That's very quick, by the way. There's a lot of things that will happen.
Okay, the sisters have a question related to the topic.
Yes. What do you have to say to those who say Islam is a copy of Christianity?
What was it again?
That Islam is a copy of Christianity.
What would I say to people who say Islam is a copy of Christianity? I would say that Islam is much a copy of Christianity as a Volkswagen is a copy of a Mercedes-Benz. They're both cars, but they're not alike. It's just the reality. It's just the reality. But I will tell you one thing. I will tell you one small thing. And this is also in a movie called The Message, where we know that the Negus of Abyssinia, of Ethiopia, when he heard the Quran recited to him, chapter Mary actually, about the birth of Jesus, he said to Jafar, wasn't it? Jafar ibn Abi Talib. He said to him that what you tell me and what we have is like two rays coming from the same lamp. And he allowed those Muslims to live in his kingdom peacefully, and he eventually accepted Islam and became a Muslim. And the Prophet, peace be upon him, prayed for him when he heard that he died. So that's how similar they are. Yes.
Do we have any more questions from the sisters related to the topic?
Yes. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
My mother is a Jehovah's Witness.
Mm-hmm.
So she doesn't believe that God is three.
Yep.
So what could I say to her to make her believe that Islam is the right religion?
Now, thank you for your question. Did everybody hear it? Her mom's a Jehovah's Witness, which Jehovah's Witnesses do not believe in the Trinity. They don't believe in birthdays. They don't a lot of things they don't believe in. They're very close to Islam. They're probably one of the sects, other than Unitarians and things like that, that are really on the edge of where we are. It's a very open-ended question because there's a lot of things you could tell her. There's a lot of things you could tell her. But one thing that is very clear is that if you look at what Jesus taught, forget about anyone else for a minute. Forget about the disciples. Forget about Paul. Forget about any of this. Tell your mom, go get the red letter edition Bible. You know what that means, right? The red letter edition. Tell her to go get the red letter edition of Bible and only read what is in red. Only read what is in red and ask her, is her way of life in accordance with that? Because that's what Jesus taught. Forget everybody else for a moment. Read the red only. And I'm telling you, when you read only the red, you find something that is so close to Islam that it's scary. But it's the black that really messes it all up. The red is about 95% in accordance with what we believe. Thank you. And if you want some more questions, just go to my website, yushaevans.com. There's a button that says contact. Ask me that question there, and I'll probably have already answered it, so I can forward it to you, or I'll answer it personally. Cha'am. Godwin. Any other questions?
Yeah, we have one more question. If Jesus said God is one, why does the Trinity exist?
Asking me why the Trinity exists is like asking me why the moon exists. It just does. But the Trinity as we know it, is deduced from some of the implicit statements of Jesus. But there's only one explicit statement, really plainly explicit, that talks about Trinity. And it's in 1 John 5, verse 7, where it said, there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. These three are one. And there are three that bear record on earth, the water, the blood, and the Spirit. And these three agree as one. This is the compendium for the understanding that everything that Jesus said was about this. Unfortunately, biblical scholars themselves have proved that this was never a part of the original writings of the Bible. This did not come into the existence until the Latin Vulgate. So biblical scholars in the 50s, when they made something called the NSRV, which is no longer in print, the New Standard Revised Version of the Bible, this is one of the verses that they tossed out. Along with the story of Jesus forgiving the adulteress and some other things, they tossed it out. And these are biblical scholars. A college of biblical scholars of repute said that 1 John 5 and 7 was never a part of the original documents. It only comes in the Latin Vulgate, so it is flicked out. But Jesus taught God was one. Thank you. Any other questions? We have any questions here?
We have many questions here.
Okay, let's take a couple and then we'll go back.
Do we have any? Okay. Do we have any more from the sisters?
We have one more that is related to the one that I just asked. There's a sister asking for advice on how to give nasiha or da'wah to her mother who believes that God is three and make her believe that God is one.
My answer will be the same to the other sister. Tell her to go read the red letter edition of the Bible. Read only the red. Leave everything out. If you can find Trinity in that, then we have a serious problem. Because Jesus only spoke implicitly in verses like I and the Father are one and things of this nature. But his explicit statements are clearly distinguish himself from the God that he worshipped. So the Trinity is not something that Jesus taught. It's something that came about later. Even if we look at early church history, the debate that raged on for the first three centuries of Christianity was about the nature of Jesus. There were churches, there were places of worship throughout Palestine, throughout Northern Africa, throughout East Africa, that believed in Jesus as a Messiah, as God as one, and him as a prophet and messenger and Messiah. These churches were eradicated after the councils of Nicaea. After the councils of Nicaea were concluded, and these bishops who were from Rome, who had the power and the prestige, just like politics today, when the politics were played, and they decided that Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the Acts of the Apostles, and the writings of Paul are what we're going to believe, and our creed is what we're going to believe, and anyone who disagrees with it, you will have your tongue cut out, you will have your books burned, you will be imprisoned, you will be killed. So this is what happened to the eradication of the early church who followed Jesus. We not only have witness from that from historical documents, but also in Islam, we have a witness from a man named Salman al-Farsi, a Persian man who said he used to worship Jesus as one, as a prophet, as a messenger, and that there were very few people left on earth. And his last teacher, who was a follower of Jesus, the Christ, the Messiah, told him, and we have this on very good account, told him, go to the city of Medina, which was known as Yathrib at the time, because the next messenger is going to come. This is what he's going to look like, and he's going to have a seal of prophethood on his shoulder between his two, on his back between his shoulders. And Salman al-Farsi said that is exactly what happened when he heard the prophet was there. He went and he saw him, and the prophet said, are you looking for this on my back? And he showed it to him, and Salman al-Farsi accepted Islam because this is what he was told to do by his followers or his teachers who followed Jesus Christ. So we have the historical reference. Any other questions?
Jazakallah khair, Sheikh. We have a question about any messenger. Did Jesus prophesy any messengers after him?
Did Jesus prophesy any messenger after him? Yes. But again, it can be interpreted because some people will consider this implicit. Muslims consider it explicit, but it can be considered explicit. When Jesus said, I have to go, so the parakletos, which is the Greek word that is used, which Jesus did not speak, the parakletos, meaning the comforter, meaning the one who will bring comfort, the one who will bring mercy, that person, and when he used parakletos, it's speaking of a person, even in the Greek language. It's not speaking of something that you use esoteric, intangible. It was speaking of a person. He said, I must go so that the parakletos, the comforter, can come. And when he comes, because Jesus said, I have many things I want to tell you, but you can't bear them right now. Jesus said, I have many things I want to share with you, but right now you can't handle it. I have to go so that the comforter can come. But when he comes, he will tell you all truths. And he will say that which is put in his mouth, he will speak. Paraphrasing in the King James Version. But he did describe that he must go so something else can come. And that thing that comes will abide with you forever. Is that true? Has the messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, does he not abide with us from now to the end of time? Why? Because we have everything he said, he did, how he acted, how he looked, how he ate, how he slept, how he drank, how he got married, how he was with his wives, how he was with his children, how he was as a ruler, as a leader, as a father, as a son, as a husband. We have all of it. He is with us forever, and you can't get rid of it. So yeah, he did prophesize the coming messenger after him. And it is prophesied before Jesus in Song of Solomon chapter 5, where it says, and the one to come, his name shall be Muhammad, in the Hebrew language. Go ask any Jew that knows Hebrew to recite for you Song of Solomon chapter 5. You will find the name Muhammad is there. And there's a lot more, but we don't have time for that. It's another lecture.
Does the sisters have any more questions?
Yeah. If a non-Muslim accepts that God is one and Jesus is not the Son of God, but doesn't accept Islam 100%, what advice do you have to make them accept Islam?
Okay, so repeat it again because I missed the very portion at the last.
If they accept that God is one and Jesus is not the Son of God, what advice do you have to give to make them complete their whole belief in becoming Muslim?
Sure. If someone believes that God is only one, alone, with no partners, and they believe Jesus is a messenger of God, they are pretty much already there. They are on the footsteps of Islam. They are on the footsteps of Islam. The only thing required of them now is to also include in their beliefs, belief in the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and accepting that, saying that I believe there's only one God, and that Muhammad is his messenger, and Jesus is also his messenger and his slave, and they will be a Muslim. This is as simple as it gets. And you know, one thing that about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I was telling Sheikh Haytham yesterday on our way back, that when I accepted Islam, I went to the Imam's house after reading the Quran, and I told him I want to be a Muslim. He said, why? Because he was shocked. I'd only been gone for 3 days. I said, because I read this book and it is what you say it is. It is the truth from God. He said, okay, hold on a second. To be a Muslim, you have to believe there's only one God. I said, I got that. That's what the book says. I told you I believe in that book. He said, okay, but in order to be a Muslim, you also have to believe in the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, as a messenger. I said, hold on a second. He said, so come in, let me tell you about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I said, answer me one question about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that'll be all I need. He said, what? I said, did he give us this book? Is he the one who gave us this book? He said, yes. I said, then he's a messenger. That's it. This is his testimony. This is his evidence. This book is the evidence of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I want to ask all of you a question real quick before I don't get a chance to. I got 5 minutes. Anyone in here who believes in Moses, raise your hand. Good number. Put your hand down. How many of you believe that Moses did miracles? Raise your hand. Have another ijma in the room. How many of you witnessed with your own two physical eyes one of the miracles that Moses performed in his lifetime? Raise your hand. Got no vampires in the room that have lived that long? No, so nobody was there. Okay, we got that out of the way. How many of you believe in Jesus? Raise your hand. Oh, by the way, for our guests, put your hands down. If you don't believe in Jesus, you can't be a Muslim. It's a tenet of faith. We are one of the only world religions, the only world religion that says you must believe in Jesus Christ in order to be a Muslim. If you don't, you're not. How many of you believe Jesus did miracles? Raise your hand. Lots of them. Hands down. How many one of you witnessed one of the miracles Jesus performed in his lifetime with your own two physical eyes? You watched him and you saw it, or you saw the person who he did it to, or you saw the wine that he turned from water, or you saw Lazarus, or you met one of these things he did. How many of you witnessed it? No, none of us were here at that time, right? That's gone, it's past. How many of you in here believe in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam? How many of you believe he did miracles? Anyone in this room witnessed with their own two physical eyes one of the miracles that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did in his lifetime? What is that miracle? The Quran. The Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said every prophet was sent with miracles to prove who he was, and the miracle that I was sent with was the Quran. You can say the splitting of the moon, there's still evidence by NASA that the moon was once cracked in half and all this, forget about that. I can go get a Quran off that table and give it to you and say, here's the miracle of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is why we say about him, Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. Jesus was the messenger of Allah. Moses was the messenger of Allah. But Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah, and he will be into the day of judgment. Any questions?
We have a very important question here. I want to become Muslim, but I'm afraid that I will fail a little bit back and forth before I become Muslim. Should I take the testimony of faith?
Good question. The person wants to know, they want to become a Muslim, but they're afraid of, you know, falling back and forth into and out of sin and not doing what they're supposed to do. They don't think they're good enough yet to be a Muslim. How many of you in this room every single day fall in and out of sin? How many of you are going to do it every day probably of the rest of your life? How many of you are Muslim? It's just the nature of the human being. We're never going to be perfect. That's one thing that a lot of religions have misunderstood, is that God doesn't want perfection. He created you perfect. لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا فِي أَحْسَانِ تَقْوِيمِ. He created you perfect. But that free will, the moment you became old enough to choose right and wrong, God already knew you were going to make wrong choices. That's all part of the process that we talked about yesterday. That's all part of the process. God knew that you were going to make mistakes, and He created you with that ability so that some of you would come back to Him and He would forgive you. We talked about that yesterday. So you will never be good enough to be a Muslim. Is anyone in this room good enough? They think Allah deserves to make them Muslim. None of us. We're not good enough. None of us will ever be good enough for the guidance that has been given to us. It's a gift that is not repayable. We just try every single day, and we beg every single day, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم, guide me to the straight path, guide me to the straight path. That's how we make it every day. So if you're ready to become a Muslim, do it now. Because those things that you slipped on before, there's one thing I know about Islam. The Prophet, peace be upon him, said, Islam erases everything that came before it. I wish I would have accepted Islam yesterday. But it was 15 years ago, unfortunately. But Islam erases everything that came before it. So if you want to get rid of all of that today, today is the day to get rid of your burden and enter into a new life of Islam and start fixing your relationship with the one who created you. Don't wait. Don't wait. And for those Muslims who are still sinning and you're still doing the wrong thing, don't wait. You're going to hear about Tawbah today, I think, inshallah, from our dear Sheikh Riyadh, correct? Don't wait. Fix that relationship today. Tomorrow? Jannah today, Tawbah is tomorrow or Monday? One tomorrow of the other. Tawbah will
today
be coming.
Tawbah is tomorrow, Tour of Paradise is today.
MashaAllah. The Tour of Paradise is before the Tawbah. MashaAllah. You're gonna be, trust me, after this Tour of Jannah, when he tells you Tawbah, there won't be a person in this room with a dry eye that might not be on the floor. Because the only way you get Jannah is Tawbah. Any other questions?
What does Islam say about Apostle Paul?
About what?
Paul. What does Islam say about Paul?
Islam doesn't, there's no consensus message about Paul. But let me tell you about Paul. Paul is someone on the day of judgment, I don't want to be anywhere near. First and foremost, I want to know what's waiting for him. But Paul is someone who, I'm not sure, and no scholar that I've spoken to is sure, what happened with Paul. Was he a saboteur? Was he a saboteur in order to disrupt Christianity or what the followers of Jesus were doing from within? Or was he just fooled by Satan on the road to Damascus when he thought he saw Jesus? That we cannot answer, whether it was blatant or whether he was fooled. But one thing we do know is he destroyed the teachings of Jesus. He told people to break the law. In Galatians, he commanded them to break the law. He said the law is cursed, and Jesus was cursed on behalf of it to remove it from us. And Jesus said anybody who breaks the law and tells someone to break the law, they are the lowest person in the kingdom of heaven. So Paul either was a saboteur or he himself was fooled and duped. But even when Paul met the disciples of Jesus, when he met Barnabas, they had a falling out because Barnabas said, hold on a second. What you're teaching is not what I heard from Jesus, and I saw the man myself. And he fell out with the other disciples when they got to know him. And Jesus and Paul, when he returned to Jerusalem at the last part of his life, Paul returned to Jerusalem. Does anyone know what the city of Jerusalem did? They all came out to kill him. They all came out to kill him. And the guards of Caesar came and got him and protected him and took him away. And that was the end of what we know about Paul. So Paul did not really see eye to eye with the disciples nor the followers of Jesus at any point. It was the later churches and the letters that were written to churches who were outside of Jerusalem, who were outside of the disciples' reach, that Paul had an influence on. But we don't have time for the history of Paul. I wish we did. Paul's an interesting man.